Well, good morning. My name's Kenny Borthwick. I'm remembering fond memories of when I was with you in person at Storehouse Church. And it's good to be with you yet again in this way. It's June the 21st, which is Father's Day. And I want to take that into consideration as I share God's word with you this morning. And to help us do that, let's turn to the scriptures and read together. We're going to read from Matthew chapter 21 and then into chapter 22. So Matthew 21 from verse 42. This is what Jesus says to those who were arguing with him and with his authority and with his message. So Matthew 21 verse 42. Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. And then moving into chapter 22 of Matthew's Gospel, and we break in at verse 34. But when the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." Well, amen, and may God bless to us these readings from his word. May give us understanding of them, and to his name be the glory and the praise. It's hard, actually, just as we turn to God's word, just by way of introduction, it's always hard to share one's own personal spiritual experiences. Sometimes I think it is profitable, and that's why I want to do it this morning. But I always feel a bit reluctant, because if you share a spiritual experience, it almost suggests that you're more spiritual than you are. And I don't want to give that impression at all. I'm a sinner saved by grace to be a child of God. And when God gives us spiritual experiences, it's never because we deserve them. It's all of his mercy. It's all of his grace. But I did have a dream on one occasion, and I'm not suggesting that in this dream I saw what Jesus really looks like. I'm not suggesting that at all. But I find that often it's in my dreams that somehow God sorts things out for me in my thinking. Maybe areas where I'm distressed, or areas where I'm really needing to hear from him, and perhaps even through reading the scriptures I've not been hearing him clearly, and he wants me to be clear about something. And I had a dream one night, and in this dream, Jesus came towards me. And I just knew, sometimes I know in my knower, do you know what I mean? And I knew in my dream that he was somehow going to show me what was uppermost, deepermost in his heart, what made him tick, as it were. And I wonder what you would say is uppermost, deepermost in Jesus' heart. Well, anyway, back to my dream. In the dream, he simply pulled aside his outer robe, and I saw his heart, as it were, beating, almost fluorescent red. And I knew that what I was hearing in the beat of that heart was, "Your will, Father. Your will, Father." You know, I wonder if you would have thought that when Jesus peeled away his robe and I heard the beat of his heart, maybe you would have thought it would be the lost Father, the need of the world for salvation, my love, my compassion for the lost. But of course, the one leads into the other. First and foremost, for Jesus, it was your will, Father, because he loved the Father. And this is why the Father loved him, that his heart was so in tune. They were one, of course they were, Father, Son, and Spirit. This is why the Father loved his Son when his Son came in the flesh, so in tune with his heart to save the world. This is why he loved his Son. Because his Son willingly laid down his life that he might take it up again for the sake of the sheep. Nobody took his life away from him. He laid it down. Your will, Father. Your will, Father. And you know, I find that that's a lesson that I want to begin with on this Father's Day. That Jesus, the Son, it shows us what doing the Father's will looks like. He knew what was most in the Father's heart. He was most attuned to the Father's will. And just as We want to know the love of the Father for us. So we want to know replicated in our lives the obedience of the Son towards the Father. And that's what I want to talk about today. I think I want to share with you really effectively 2 points today, just 2 points. And the first is what I would call a general point, something that I believe the Father is saying, that Jesus wants to show us of the Father's will, a general point that I think he's actually saying in these days of lockdown. Just as things begin to open up, as it were, and of course it looks as though to gather as a congregation, then that may be a few steps away at the moment, but certainly we're on course for that, however long it takes. So lockdown is beginning to open up, and I'm wondering what the Father is saying, as it were, to his church in general. And that's what I want to talk about in my first point. And then I want to share something specifically that I feel the Lord has laid in my heart for you, for Storehouse congregation. So that's where we're going this morning. And first of all, what is the Father saying in these days to the church in general? Well, you know, I think it would be a shame if we're simply looking on these days of lockdown as an interruption to the life of the church, and we just can't wait till it's over so that we can get back to business as usual. You know, sometimes interruptions are not interruptions. They're actually God getting our attention. And it's easy for us to turn away the challenge of what God might be saying and simply look upon an interruption as an interruption, and once it's over it's back to business as usual. I think it would be sad if that's all that we took from lockdown. I remember, please forgive me, I don't often do this, but I remember having another dream, and I felt in that dream that God was showing me something of his purposes to revive his work in Scotland. And it came in the form of a dream about a stone lion, one of the ones actually in George Square in Glasgow. And God seemed to say to me that that represented where things were spiritually in Scotland, that the soul of his people, as it were a bit sleepy. They were like a sleeping stone lion. That Scotland had once been fierce for Jesus Christ, but it seemed as though God was saying it was sleeping. But, you know, I saw that stone lion awaking. I felt that was a sign from God that he's got purposes of life for his people in Scotland. And as that stone lion came alive, I saw it wandering into a church. And you know what happened? When the lion wandered into the church, the people all got out of the building as fast as they could. Well, I guess you would. If a lion wandered out, it wandered in when you were gathering in your building, a Storehouse Church, I guess you'd try and get out of there pretty soon, pretty quickly, as fast as you could. And what the congregation did in my dream was they put down their hymn books, and when they came back in after the lion had left, after the interruption as it were, they picked up their hymn books and began to sing at exactly the same line as they'd been singing when they left the building. The lion was simply an interruption to them. They'd not recognised the purposes of God. I believe that in these days of interruption, God is at work in that interruption. And I think one of the things that he's doing is actually calling us to what he's always wanted his people to be. Do you remember how Jesus tells us of what the Father's will is? Do you remember in that story, in the first reading from Matthew chapter 21, he tells us this: the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Therefore, I tell you The kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to those producing its fruit. And the one who falls in this stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. Listen to what we're told in Matthew chapter 21. It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer. My house shall be called a house of prayer. He says that in Matthew 21 verse 13, when he cleanses the temple. Now let me put all of that together. Jesus is telling us here the will of his Father for his own house. It's his Father's will that his house should become a place of prayer for everybody and anybody who seeks his face and wants to enter there. And you remember how Jesus describes himself? He describes himself as a foundation stone or cornerstone that the Father has dropped from heaven upon the earth. And when that stone is dropped, then it crushes everything else that thought it was the foundation stone of what God was doing in the earth. And the Pharisees and the scribes and the Sadducees and the chief priests and so on, they all felt that they were the foundation stone, and they might have quibbled amongst themselves about which was the biggest part of the foundation, and they might have rejected one another. But somehow that was the squabble that went on between them all, and the one thing that united them in their squabble. They all thought that they were the foundation stone of God's purposes in their day. And Jesus said, my Father has just dropped a mighty stone upon all of your claims. I wonder what you would say. The foundation stone, the purpose that God establishes his house for. And remember that in our day, it's not a physical temple, it's not a physical building. It's a temple built upon the foundation stone of Jesus with the living stones of his people. What is his purpose for his church? For his building the temple not made with hands. It is simply that it should be a place where the distressed and the disturbed and those weary and those harassed should be able to come into our midst, into our gatherings, and cry out to the Lord from the distress of their living and the distress of their lives. I wonder if that's what you want Storehouse Church to become more and more, because this is Father's Day and Jesus is telling us what his Father's will for his house really is. Do you remember how Jesus, he looked upon the crowds and he was moved with compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. I was sharing in another recorded sermon not long ago a story that I believe came out of David Watson's ministry, and it was about a wee boy, and the wee boy belonged to a church where the pastor and his wife had tragically just lost one of their children. And in the same street in which the wee boy lived, there was another family that had just lost a child. And the wee boy said to his mum one day, he said, Mum, I'm so concerned for that family down the road from us because they've lost a child. And his mum quizzed him a bit and said, What about the pastor and his wife? Are you concerned for them and their loss? He said, oh yes, I'm concerned for them, I'm praying for them too, but I'm really concerned for the family down the road because they've not got Jesus and they don't know what to do. That's really profound coming from a wee boy. That's touching the heart of Jesus when he looks upon the world and he sees that so many people are like harassed and helpless sheep without a shepherd. And somehow he wants his church to become a place from which the message goes out very clearly, very tangibly. When you feel like that, you can come here. You can come and be with us. Because we've discovered that there's a God in heaven that we can cry to, who hears our cries, who hears our prayers. There's a God in heaven whose ear is attentive to the cries of the hapless and the helpless and the needy, and in whom we can find refuge and strength, and to whom, because of Jesus, we can go and receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. I think the challenge that I'm feeling in these days of lockdown, it's easy for me to say this when I'm not involved anymore in local church leadership, as it were, but the real challenge for any congregation, I believe, is, are we going to do what would bring our Father happiness and joy? Will we really make the priority that he has for his church, for his body of people, will we really make that our utmost priority as well? How would that affect what you do in Storehouse? How would it affect your mission? How would it affect even the shape of Sunday services? Do you remember how Jesus' services, for want of a better word, were interrupted sometimes by the cry of the needy and the disturbed and the helpless, and those whose lives were still held in the lostness of Satan's grip? And somehow in the presence of Jesus, sometimes they could get quite noisy. Maybe you're wanting to say, well, everything in church is meant to be done in a dignified way. That's absolutely true, but think of the Gadarene demoniac and all the display that went on around that. It maybe didn't look very dignified as it was happening, but if you'd gone to one of the demoniac's family, to his children who'd had to put up the mockery of their friends saying, we heard your dad in the graveyard last night. We saw him running about naked. If you'd been one of his children, if you'd been his wife, and asked, was what Jesus did decent and in order? They'd have pointed to the man, the husband, the father, sitting there fully clothed and in his right mind. And they would have said, of course it was decent, of course it was in order. So how do we make church a place where those whom Jesus looked upon with compassion because they were harassed and helpless, how do we make it, how do we make the Father's house a place where anybody can come and cry out to him and not be silenced? Sometimes, you know, I think just hearing a word from God and saying yes is the way by which the actual happening of that word is released. I remember a time in Thurso where God just said to me, get ready for the first fruits. And I just said, yes, Lord, to what he said to me. And the very next Sunday, two people were saved from the most unlikely backgrounds. They'd never had any connection with the church or any church people. They just appeared and were saved. So I wonder if even just saying, "Yes, Lord, make storehouse a place of prayer for anybody, a place where anybody can cry out to you." I wonder if you as a leadership and together as a fellowship are willing to say yes to that. I wonder what might happen. So that's the first point I wanted to make this morning. And as I say, I think that's a challenge for many parts of the church, for all congregations, perhaps a challenge that's there all the time. How deeply have we aligned ourselves with what pleases the Father for his temple, for his living temple, for his priorities, for what happens there? And the second thing is more specific. It's maybe not directly even connected with what I've been actually saying there. And all I can say is I do seek to listen for when I'm invited in, as it were, to speak to a congregation. And I try and hear what I think the Lord is saying. And that's why I also read from Matthew chapter 22 about the greatest commandment. Because I felt actually it was the next one, as it were, after the greatest commandment, that when I came before the Lord and prayed for you as a congregation, I wonder if this is a stone that just needs to, you just need to make it sure it's there on top of the foundation stone of Jesus. Because I felt my attention drawn to the second greatest commandment. And you remember that we read of it in Matthew chapter 22. We read there, verse 39, the second great commandment is like the first. You shall love your neighbour as yourself. And I actually found myself drawn, and again, this was for you, as I was thinking through this, I found myself drawn to look up Leviticus 19:18, which is where that second great commandment is actually written. Leviticus 19:18, you shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbour as yourself. I am the Lord. I found it interesting, just as I thought of that I don't think I'd ever quite noticed that with enough attention before. If I were to ask you what the essence of loving your neighbour as yourself was, I wonder what you would say. I'd never seen with enough attention that Leviticus 19 actually tells us in verse 18, seems to say that the very essence of loving our neighbour as ourselves is not bearing a grudge against them. And grudges can go on for a long time. Here in verse 18, it seems as though they can even span the generations, as it were. I don't know all of your history, but I do know, and I don't mean to open up any unhappiness needlessly, but I felt this was the way the Lord led me. I know that you did go through some distressing times. I've never sought to know the details of that, so please hear me. I'm speaking, as it were, from a vacuum. I don't know the details, but I think the Lord may be wanting to say, maybe just to check up in your hearts, that there's no grudge bearing that's been left live, as it were, from these days. That there's no spirit of blame, that there's no spirit of accusation, either among yourself or towards any individuals among yourself, among the leadership, towards the leadership, towards others who are maybe no longer part of you, or whatever it may be, whatever direction this may go in. I wonder if God is maybe asking you just to search your hearts to make sure that there's no grudge bearing there, that actually you're walking in harmony with the God who forgives. God could bear a grudge against any one of us, couldn't he? But isn't it amazing that even the things that he would be justified in bearing a grudge against us for, he completely forgives us and moves our sins out the reckoning and as far as the east is from the west, when we come before him and ask him for forgiveness. And part of the essence of forgiveness is it's something that flows like a river, and if we're not willing to pass it on, then we can't actually receive it from the Lord. And so I guess I'm wondering, is there maybe someone, some group, some individual that maybe some of us have still to forgive from our heart? That puts us so in tune with what pleases the Father. And as I've said, this is Father's Day, and surely we would want to do that. It seems that unforgiveness certainly displeases him, so much so that it can stop the flow of experience, grace in our lives. Forgiveness is our way of showing that we have the heart of Jesus towards the Father, that we're willing to offer forgiveness even before somebody admits any wrong. And we don't wait for them to admit wrong before forgiveness is flowing from our hearts. Maybe to admit wrong is necessary for there to be reconciliation of relationship, but it's not necessary for forgiveness to be offered. What does it mean to forgive? Well, R.T. Kendall in his book Total Forgiveness says one of the things it means is this: you let the person off the hook. You're no longer relating to them on the basis of they did this wrong. Number two, this is the second thing he says it means. You actually pray for them that they'll be blessed. And number three, you don't keep talking about the wrong thing that so-and-so did to the church, in the church, towards me, towards my friends, towards my loved ones. You don't keep talking about it, because keeping talking about it is really, it can be your way of bringing somebody down in the eyes of another person. So I wonder, is there somebody or a group of people, and churches can easily divide into factions, can't they? I don't know. I don't know what the past may have left as a residue. And I'm simply asking for each one of us to face up to this, perhaps for the leadership to face up to it as individual leaders and as a collective leadership or whatever. Is there someone I'm needing to forgive? Or a group I'm needing to forgive? To let off the hook. To pray that they'll be blessed. And to stop telling the story to everybody. Grudge bearing kills relationships. In fact, it literally killed John the Baptist, according to Mark chapter 6. he died, he was killed, he was murdered because Herodias bore him a grudge. And where grudges exist, certainly, at least metaphorically, there'll always be a death, there'll always be a murder. There'll always be a killing of relationship. And so on this Father's Day, there's a couple of things that I believe God has put in my heart. Are we going to please the Father on Father's Day? Pardon me. Are we going to say, Father, I want what your son said you wanted in your house. I want Storehouse Church. I want my life, as it were, to be a place where others can come and cry from their need and find that there's a God who cares. Is that how my life is going to be structured? Is that going to be how Storehouse Church is structured? And the second thing on that foundation stone, as it were, is there an issue of forgiveness I need to face up to? It's so freeing, isn't it, to get rid of grudge bearing. That's something that can eat us away, and it can destroy the life of a leadership of a congregation. It can destroy the internal harmony of a congregation. It can destroy the collective witness in a town. It can eat away at me personally. I think I'm offering you the way of freedom and joy and life on this Father's Day. So may God bless whatever is of him, whatever you need to hear, may you hear it. Whatever is merely me, and I guess every sermon will be a bit of a mix, whatever is merely me, just put it aside. But make sure before you do that you're not putting aside something that is from the Lord who cares about you, cares about his church. So God bless, and bye for now.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a sin. Wonderful, sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Good morning. We come again around the Lord's table and this to this service of remembrance and thanksgiving for all His love and His goodness to us. And as Paul said, what I received from the Lord I also passed on to you, that on the night when the Lord Jesus was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And so we come this morning to the service of remembrance and thanksgiving. And we remember that Paul tells us in the book of Romans, "Just at the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Since we now have been justified by His blood, how much more will we be saved from God's wrath through Him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to Him through the death of His Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through His life?" And we come in accordance with the Lord's instructions to take the bread and take the wine and give thanks for it and share it together in memory and thankfulness of the love and grace which He bestowed to us on Calvary's cross. I just want to pray the words of a hymn this morning to us. It says, "Here I am, and I have come to thank You, Lord, for all You've done. Thank You, Lord. You paid the price at Calvary. You shed Your blood. You set me free. Thank You, Lord. No greater love has ever been shown, no better life was ever laid down. You took my sin, You took my shame, You drank my cup, You bore my pain. Thank You, Lord. You broke the curse, You broke the chain, in victory from death You rose again. Thank You, Lord. And not by works, but by Your grace, You clothe me now in righteousness." Let's pray. Father, we thank You that as we have read these words, and it sums up just what the cross of Calvary means to us this morning. The pain and suffering that You bore on our behalf, for the forgiveness of our sins, the blood which flowed to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We thank You, Lord, for these things. And as we come and share this bread and wine in the way that you ordained it, we are indeed proclaiming the Lord's death, which is the gospel of salvation, again this morning. And we would ask, dear Father, that as we are gathered in this way, that you will indeed, by your Spirit, prepare us to be your servants for the sake of the gospel. You called you and set apart your disciples and gave them a commission, Lord. And this same commission applies to us, that we go into all the world and preach the gospel. And by your Spirit and your enabling, dear Father, help us to be such disciples. We come, and as we will break the bread and we will share the cup, dear Father, in remembrance of your great goodness and your love. And accept our thanks then again this morning, dear Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus, at the end of the Last Supper, he took the bread and he broke it and said, "Take, eat, in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup, which is the new covenant for us by his blood, because without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. And we drink the cup this morning in memory of God's love and grace to us. And in closing, the final verse of that hymn I read earlier says, "You bid me come, you make me whole, you give me peace, you restore my soul. Thank you, Lord. You fill me up, and when I'm full, you give me more till I overflow. Thank you, Lord. You're making me to be like you, to do the works of the Father too." And so in closing, as we have read these words, "You, to do the works of the Father do," we pray this morning that the message from the table will be that we have been saved to serve. And by your Spirit, Lord, make us truly faithful servants. In Jesus' name, Amen.